Hi guys, that's me Krishna Kumar, back with yet another session on chemistry at your fingertips. Now in this session, basically we are going to talk about the periodic table. Now all of us know that whether you are considering preparation for CET, NEET or JEE, the periodic table is going to be an integral part and you have S and P block elements which basically cover a lot. Right now, especially the P block elements, they carry basically the maximum weightage. So you have to understand that you should be very much clear with both the S block and the P block elements. Now S block elements are pretty much simple to understand. The reactions are very much easier, but more focus has to be done on the exceptions and followed by the P block elements. And you have certain things that you will be studying in, you might have studied in class 11th and you know group 13, 14, 15, 16 and all, and even 17, correct? So a certain part, like for example, nitrogen family, oxygen family and all, up to the inert gases you are studying in class 12th. Okay, so now this periodic table, these elements of this periodic table like S and P block elements have to be done properly along with their exceptions and reactions. I do agree that, you know, many of you say that there are a lot of reactions and it's practically impossible for each student to just mug up everything, but at least you can do the periodic trends, you can do the exceptions and try to solve tricky MCQs, which will definitely be a good supplement to your existing preparation. Now, as far as reactions are concerned, many of you might have done these reactions in your lower classes. So you just need to do the ones which are extra, which are not more. So you will be able to understand if you start studying this and if you start studying this in depth. But the most important is to understand the periodic trends. Okay. Now we are going to talk about the S block elements. So in this video, basically we are going to study about the introduction, their occurrence, their general electronic configuration, and certain basic facts. Okay, so now let's start our session. Before we start with this session, I just want you to understand the importance of the lockdown which is there in this country. Now we already know that this world is fighting, India is basically fighting with the COVID-19. Okay, so it's very much necessary to make sure that we stay at home so that we don't transition from stage 2 to stage 3, right? So that the infection can be controlled. So it's my polite request to stay at home and do not move out for the till the lockdown process ends. And most important thing, take care of yourself, maintain proper hygiene, keep washing your hands frequently and maintain the desired level of cleanliness within you, I mean, within your surrounding as well. Okay, so basically we are going to start with the S block elements. Now, let's talk a little bit about the S block elements. Now, S block elements, they are called as alkali metals because the word alkali is derived from the another word, alkali, which basically means the ashes of plants basically, which are rich in carbonates of sodium and potassium. That's basically sodium carbonate and potassium carbonate. Okay. Now, when you talk about the periodic table, it's divided into there are two major components which you normally study, groups and the periods. Okay. Groups means basically top to bottom, and then when you talk about period, it's basically from left to right, which you normally call it as groups. Okay, so we are going to study group 1, which is basically alkali metals. And why are they basically called as alkali metals? Yes, I'm using the word basic many times because oxides of these elements like sodium, potassium and all, they are alkaline in nature, basic in nature, right? So that's basically the reason we normally call them as alkali metals. Okay, now let's try to understand what are we going to study. In this group 1, we'll be studying about lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium and francium. So basically group 1 consists of lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium and francium, right? So hydrogen is not included because, you know, of its a different behavior. The position of hydrogen is still undefined, or it's still not decided in the periodic table because it's just containing one electron, so it can donate, it can receive, it can show a property like H plus H minus. So that definitely, let's keep that aside, right? So group 1 consists of lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium and francium. So here are the electronic configuration. For lithium, it's 2 It is basically 2-1, that is the general electronic configuration in terms of K shell, L shell, but we already know that we are supposed to write it in terms of sp and d, sp, d and f subshells. Okay, so if you could see here, the general electronic configuration for all these elements, it is ns1. N is basically the principal quantum number, which is also called as the period number, and the number 1, that is when you talk about like ns1, right? The first one is basically the group number. Okay, so if you could see here, in the case of lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium and francium, the last electron enters in the S subshell. So it is generally called as S block elements. So you already know the entire periodic table is divided into S block, P block, D and the F block element. So S block elements are going to be the general part of our discussion. Okay. So for the time being, just try to understand the general electronic configuration is NS1. Okay, now apart from all these, when you notice about lithium is basically 1s2, 2s1. The remaining elements, they show the penultimate shell. That is, when you talk about sodium, it's going to be 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, so and then 3s1. So 3s1 is the last shell. So 2s2, 2p6 total contain 8 electrons. So 8 electrons are present in the penultimate shell. But when you talk about lithium, it contains only 2 electrons in the penultimate shell, right? So all these elements, if you could see here, can lose one electron from the S subshell and can attain octet in the penultimate shell, 8 electrons in the penultimate shell basically. So they are basically group 1 cations. So they are monovalent in nature, right? And the valency shown is plus, valency shown is 1. Now let's talk a little bit about the occurrence. Now in the nature, they occur in different forms. Let's talk about lithium. It occurs in the form of spodumene and petalite. So these are the general formula. And sodium, it's rock salt, borax, glober salt, cryolite, natron, trona and mirabilite. The formula is already there in front of the screen. Okay, now when you talk about the potassium, it's Indian salt, KNO3, sylvite, carnelite, feldspar, which is also called as kaolin, right? Now, if you could talk about these elements, so when you just understand, like, how do we isolate these elements from their ores or minerals? Now, basically, if you could see here, these elements are ready to lose one electron. They have the general tendency to undergo oxidation. So they are basically very good reducing agents, correct? So their oxides can be reduced to get a metal, but practically here in this case, it's not possible because they are highly reactive, right? So even when you do electrolysis of their aqueous solution, it's very difficult. Let's say if you use mercury cathode, still there is a problem. Mercury forms amalgam with these. So separation using electrolysis of aqueous solution is difficult. Now this is a very important aspect when for your entrance exam. These group 1 elements, they cannot be obtained by electrolysis of their aqueous solution even when you use mercury cathode, because they generally form amalgams, right? Alloys of mercury. So basically they form amalgams, and recovery of the metal is pretty much difficult in that case. Okay, so this is just a little bit introduction about these elements. Now let's talk about if we cannot obtain them by hydrolysis, how do we get them, right? So we not hydro hydrolysis sorry electrolysis how do we get them? So you can just isolate these elements by doing electrolysis, but not of their aqueous solution, but using their halides in the fused state, right? Now in this case, it's very much necessary to add an impurity. Now this impurity is going to lower the melting point, which is going to definitely lower the vapor pressure so that they don't catch fire. Again, it's a very important fact that if you are doing the electrolysis of fused salt, for example fused sodium chloride, an impurity is added. Or why exactly is the impurity is added? It lowers the temperature, lowers the vapor pressure, as a result of which the elements which we normally get after that, due to the lower vapor pressure, they don't catch fire, right? So these are the important aspects which you are supposed to understand about the isolation. Okay, so this was just a general introduction to the S block elements. I hope you have enjoyed watching the video. Now please stay tuned to the other parts of this particular chapter. So that, and if you like this video, please click the like button, and if you haven't subscribed, please do so that you get periodic updates of the upcoming videos. Thank you.